Fight for my soul, but heaven knows where I stand. Rains will pour, winds will blow, floods are gonna rise, oh I know. But hope ain't built on sinking
sin. Everyone, welcome to church. We're going to worship together. Who's excited to worship this morning? Well, before we do, how about we all bow our heads and let's pray together. Lord, thank you for just waking us up today. Another beautiful day where we can praise you and gather together and learn more about you and fellowship with our friends and family. So I just pray that as we sing these songs to you and as we get into your word, that we would leave this place changed, encouraged, corrected, whatever we're walking in with today. Lord, would you just meet us here right where we're at? So we love you and we worship you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Together.
All praise in the valley, all praise on the mountain, all praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting, all praise when I'm numbered, praise
on, let's worship. The word says that there's joy in the presence of the Lord, amen? So as we sing these songs, we can smile, we can have fun, because the Lord has set us free. We have no more shame, no more guilt. Isn't that amazing to walk in here knowing that we're free? Who agrees with that? Come on. So let's sing from a place of joy and freedom this morning, amen?
Turn to someone and tell them, we're never going to stop singing. We're never going to stop singing, dude. That was so awesome. As you're being seated as well, if you could please do what we call the Calvary Crunch, which is move towards the center aisle. That'll help as the ushers are coming up and still trying to seat people that are coming in. But also, if you could please silence or turn off your cell phones, that'll be a huge, huge blessing as well. We first off want to thank all of you guys who helped participate in any way, shape, and form with our Passion Week services. We had an awesome week. We had an awesome Easter services, and there was just so many of you guys that came out, ushered, parking, cooked food, all that good stuff. And from the bottom of our hearts, we just thank you guys for all your service last week, and we really appreciate you guys. Today we started our Rise and Shine service at 7:30, so if you missed out, you can come join us next Sunday. It's going to be every Sunday at 7:30. We're back there in Building 3. We have worship, and Pancho is teaching through the Word. Same study as we're having here. So make plans to join us. The marriage home studies start. They started this Friday, but today is the last day to sign up. So if you want to sign up, you can head to the marriage counter over in Building 3, and you can get signed up for that. They're going through Bible study for couples. The marriage home series. So that's happening. It's a home study. They got houses in Pico, Montebello, Norwalk, and Cerrito. So you can get at them in regards to that. Starting this Friday, we have our youth. We're kicking off TGIF. We've been announcing it for about a month now. We hope your kids can join us. It's for junior high and high school. I know there's been some confusion, like, is it only for high schoolers? It's for both junior high and high school. We're going to be barbecuing. We're going to have a bonfire back there. This Friday is going to be our kickoff, and just we're going to be having lots of fun. So bring your junior hires or high schoolers this Friday. Also, Fresh Start begins their next session Monday, April 15th. That's at 7 p.m. So if you want to be encouraged with your weight loss goals, you can do that by coming, but also you can be encouraged spiritually with the fellowship and the accountability that's there with those ladies. The GarageBand Youth and Children's Ministry Worship, they are starting GarageBand on a monthly basis starting April 20th from 10 to 12 p.m. So if your son or daughter is interested, if they have no idea how to even touch an instrument, that's okay. This is the place to start. So they're going to be encouraging in drums, in guitar, in bass. They're doing the whole works over there. They're going to have all the teachers ready to teach them all those things. So that starts April 20th. You can go and sign up. They have a table next to the food court today, so you can go and sign up over there for that. And then lastly, Surf Camp for grades 3rd through 5th grade. This is the children's ministry. They're going to be heading out to Imperial Beach in the summer. They're going to have an informational meeting Sunday the 21st after second service upstairs in the children's worship area. So it's also going to be a chance for the parents to go along and camp out on the beach and just have a good time. So make sure to mark your calendars. And that's coming up in July. So a lot going on here at the Ark. You can go to our website and check out all the other things that are happening. The food court has breakfast burritos, and they'll have tostadas as well, all going towards the worship ministry that's taking place. So let's all stand. We'll pray, and we'll lift up the offering. And then we want to continue praying for Felicia, who's there. She's fighting for her life. She's one of the daughters of one of our Arkies here, so we want to lift her up today as well. Father, we thank you so much for this day, Lord. And we lift up Felicia to you, Lord. We just hope and we pray and we ask and we plead and we beg for the mercy of God upon her life, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you would have your way with the family, their hearts and their minds, and comfort them during this trial, Lord, during this grieving, really, Lord. And as they seek you, Father, may you just meet their needs, Father, according to your good and perfect will. We lift up the offering. We ask that you bless it, Lord, and continue to use it for your purposes. And we just give you this time, Lord. May you be glorified and exalted in our midst, Lord, as we worship you, as we worship your holy Son, Jesus Christ. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name.
And generations falling down in worship, sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe, sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name. You, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. For all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Sing it out.
Sing it out, all my life.
All my life.
Amen. In a moment, we'll sing another psalm. But would you please open your Bibles to Psalm 116? And if you're physically able to stand, would you stand in reverence of God's word? If you cannot stand, it's okay. But as we stand, it's a posture of attention. It's a posture of surrender as we stand before the Lord. Psalm 116, I will read the odd numbers, and all of you in unison, Lord willing, will read the even numbers. When you're there, tell me amen. Amen. Okay, tell me when you're there, amen. Amen. Okay. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications. The pains of death surrounded me, and the pangs of hell laid hold of me. I found trouble and sorrow. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yes, our God is merciful. Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I said in my haste, all men are liars. I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord. Let's worship.
We love you. Oh, how we love you.
Amen. Amen. I like to pray for those who are battling cancer. I don't know, my heart goes out. So many people with cancer. So many people. So many people with cancer. And I just want to pray for you, your loved ones. Father, as we begin this study, thank you for the worship. Thank you for taking us to a place that we can come, bow the knee, and say to you that you are Lord and you are King. Father, we ask for your forgiveness. We ask for your mercy. We pray, Father, that you, Father, will be ever so kind and gracious to us. We don't deserve you. You're so kind. Father, I pray for those who are going through cancer. Those, Father, who are seeking treatment. Those, Father, who are getting tested for cancer. Lord, will you remind them that stress is worse than cancer? Allow them to rest in you. You're the great master physician. We pray, Father, for your healing upon them. We take this time as we pray for the person to our left. We don't know what they're going through, but we pray for them and their families. Equally, we pray for the person to our right and ask that you bless their private world. May you hear their prayer. For the person behind us, in front of us, if any, likewise, Father. We pray, Father, for those that are watching next door, and in the food court, and also, Father, those that are watching online. Help us, speak to us, we pray. We pray for our nation, we pray for our country, and Lord, may you have mercy upon America. Be with us, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Turn around and say hi to one another, would you? Amen. Would you turn with me to Joshua chapter 8, if I may? Chapter 8 of Joshua. Good morning again. Good morning. The Lord be with you. 2 weeks ago, we had to stop due to the Easter services. But we're going through the book of Joshua systematically. And we finished chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. But just to give you a reminder what is taking place. You can see in chapter 8, verses 1, immediately you see something wonderful. God speaks to Joshua. And if you're counting how many times God spoke to him, this is the 11th time that God speaks to Joshua. And the first thing that God says to Joshua, there in verse 1 of chapter 8, first two words, do not be afraid and do not be dismayed. It's a word that we don't use in English, American English, but it's the word discouragement. So something's taking place in chapter 8. I've entitled this message, The Restore Courage. There's a picture here. It's a picture over in post picture. But this is a picture, or a painting by the famous John Trumbull, 1840. You may not know him, but if you have a dollar bill, you have a picture of Washington. That's his. Also, a $2 bill, you see behind the $2 bill, and you see Philadelphia, the signing of the Constitution on the $2 bill. That's John Trumbull. John Trumbull wrote this, Joshua at the Battle of Ai, attended by death. 12,000 people were killed in the slaughter of the city of Ai. But let me first bring you a recap, if I may. If I may, oh, I don't think that's it, is that it? That's it right there. Thank you. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you so much. Let me give you a recap of what's going on. In chapter 7, the children of Israel had defeated and conquered the city of Jericho. God gave him perfect instructions. He says, I want you to destroy the city of Jericho. Everything that breeds, animals, men, dogs, everything that breeds, kill them all. Do not take the silver or the gold. The gold belongs to the treasury of the Lord. And do not take any of the accursed things. And so, up to now, everything is going smoothly. And the armies of the Lord have tasted only victory. But the situation changes. It turns dark. With defeat, sorrow, and loss of life. As the children of Israel prepare to attack the city of Ai, Joshua sends 2 spies to the city of Ai. So the 2 spies go to check out the city of Ai. They come back and tell Joshua, we got him. We don't have to bother the whole army. Just give me 2,000, 3,000 men, 3 battalions, and we'll take care of them. But lo and behold, They get run out, and they experience the tragedy of defeat. They get outrun by the city of Ai, the army of city Ai, and 36 men, warriors, are killed. The tragedy of defeat. When you look at chapter 7, the Bible says in verse 1 of chapter 7, and the children of Israel made a trespass or a sin, transgression. But in verse 1 of chapter 7, it tells you that it was one man by the name of Achan, which means trouble. Achan did something and violated the law of God there in verse 18 of chapter 6. The Bible says that he went to Babylon, he saw, he coveted, he took, he hid, and he lied. And because of that sin, all of the children of Israel had sinned. So there was sin in the camp. And so, again, one man, a single individual, violates command, and all of Israel implicated. I shared with you 3 weeks ago, as we're talking and reading Joshua chapter 7, that when a person fails or commits a tragedy or commits a crime or commits a trespass, the loved ones, his inner circle gets affected. You believe that? It's true. Even if you didn't say no, it's still true. What you do, it affects your inner circle, your parents, your grandparents, your children, your grandchildren. And so Achan kept his mouth shut, thinking he got away with it. But there was sin in the camp. And then the sorrow of defeat. As I shared with you, they go and attack Ai. But Ai says, absolutely not. And 36 men lose their lives. And Israel was chased and were struck down by the people of Ai. The Bible says that after that, that the hearts of the children of Israel melted with fear and their heart became like water. What a description. You see, this narrative that we read in chapter 8 and also including chapter 7, historically, it makes sense, historically in the church. The church has made many mistakes and errors throughout history. But equally so, churches have made mistakes. And certainly, people of God have made mistakes. I've been a Christian for 46 years. And those 46 years and 33 are being a pastor, I have made some blunders. Either the way I thought it should be, or I imposed my authority, and then I ended up being wrong. You ever felt stupid? I speak for myself. I made a mistake. And you know, when you make a mistake, you make an error, and you make an assumption, and then you feel the result, and you're an idiot. You know the feeling of regret and sorrow? How your heart hurts? You're an idiot. And you know it. That's what the children of Israel felt. They were sorrowful. Their hearts became like water. And the Bible says that Joshua and the elders of Israel, they begin to weep and mourn and sorrow and grieve before the ark of the Lord, crying all day, throwing dust up in the air, tearing their clothes and grieving. And they're saying, why, Lord, what happened? What happened, Lord? We should go back. Why are you bringing us to the desert? And there in chapter 7, verse 10, the Lord says, get up, man. What are you doing? What are you doing, Joshua? Get up. And the Lord says, there's sin in the camp. Israel has sinned. And because they committed sin, and then this is the defeat. Joshua chapter 7, verse 12 said the children of Israel were doomed to destruction. That the first step in restoring fellowship was for the people of God to sanctify themselves. The sanctification was not ceremonial, but spiritual. So what God had him in chapter 7, he told Joshua, get up for the second time. Tomorrow sanctify the people and bring all the 12 tribes. And all 12 tribes are going to go through a parade review. And every tribe, 12 tribes, are going to go through. The tribe of Reuben, go. The tribe of Gad, go. The tribe of Reuben, or the tribe of Benjamin, go. It wasn't until they came to the clan, the family, the household of Achan, that the grandfather is brought up to the front. The grandfather had done nothing. And finally, Achan. Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow there's an accursed thing in your midst, O Israel, and you cannot stand against your enemies. He said that three times. When there's sin in the camp, you cannot stand your enemies. Joshua chapter 7, verse 14 and 15. The 12 tribes are to assemble one by one, clan by clan, household by household, then man to man, and the Lord will select. And finally, we are told that the grandfather, Zabdi, was taken. And finally, Achan, the perpetrator, was spotted. Notice that he never volunteered himself. He thought, having this hidden sin, he thought he can get away with it. But the theology and the principle, biblical principle, there's a law, just like natural laws. What goes up? That's a natural law. You don't have to be a scientist. There are laws in nature. We have laws of indigestion, of digestion. What we eat must be expelled out. Hopefully. In the name of Jesus. That's just a principle. It's a law. In the same way, the Bible says, do not be deceived, my brother or sister, that whatever you sow, you finish it for me. I shall reap. You don't get away with it. You plant seeds of discord, you're going to have a harvest of discord. You plant wickedness, you're going to harvest wickedness. And that's the law. And so here, Achan thought he could get away with it, but he couldn't. So in chapter 7, verse 20 to 24, you have Achan's confession. This is where he finally confesses his sin. And then the punishment of sin. He gets stoned to death, not only him, his wife, children, and extended family, his household, everything. They get killed and stoned, and then to double the dishonor, they get burned. To triple the dishonor, they do not bury him. They entomb him above ground with rocks. It wasn't until this confession, I want you to understand that as Christians, thank God that if we ever are like Achan, and I've done some Achan things. It sounds nasty. I've done some Achan things. I've done those things. But unlike Achan, I don't get stoned. It is the grace of God. I don't get stoned. This is what you need to understand. You see, the principle here is volitional confession. As Christians, the Bible says, if we confess our sin, God is faithful, God is just to forgive us of all sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. No stones. You mean if I volitionally, that means voluntarily, it is not compulsory confession. If I confess, meaning I acknowledge that I have an Achan in my heart, that I'm hiding something. See, the theology of that is that God cannot use you. God cannot use you to the full extent when there's sin in our life, active sin, and we don't confess it. We think like Achan, we can get away with it, even though we're hurting grandpa and grandpa, everybody around us thinking we can get away with it. Not in the economy and the government of God. That doesn't work that way. And so unconfessed sin is like cancer in you. So there's confession. What is confession? To tell or to make known as something wrong or damaging to oneself. It's an admission of guilt, voluntary or volitional. Confession in Scripture is always voluntarily. David was forgiven after he confessed his sins to God. Listen to the emotion of David in Psalm 32, verse 5. Lord, I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden from you. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sins. You see, the pardon or the forgiveness in the Scriptures always supposes that there is confession, and there is no promise that it will be imparted unless there's full acknowledgement has been made. Isaiah the prophet says this, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Wow. Now, if you come from a Catholic faith, again, I'm not bashing. I'm just telling you. In order for me, before I became a Christian, Bible-believing Christian, because I was labeled a Christian, but I was not a Bible-believing Christian. In order for me to have communion, I had to do something first. What is it? Confession. But it's not voluntary, it's compulsory. If I don't do that according to the dogma, I can't take communion. So I have to go and confess my sins to a stranger who's probably worse than I am. But that's compulsory. Now, it was realized that many people do not go to confession for whatever reason, and they wait until they're dead. I mean, they're dying. And so this is where they give you the last rites. And they come up to you, and they give you the anointing, the unction. So they ask you, would you like to make a confession right there on the spot while you're dying? But not everybody gets a chance to do that. So they made it into a law in 1215. It's called the Fourth Lateran Council. They established a rule that every Christian should confess to a priest at least once a year. And then they give you penance. Penance is a rite originally reserved to those who have sinned seriously. And it becomes cultural. It becomes ritual. It becomes ceremoniously. It becomes rote. Oh, yeah, this is what I have to do. In Christianity, Old Testament, Judaism, and also Christianity, confession is voluntary. James says, confess your sins to one another so that you may be, say it loud, healed. How does that happen? What happens? What do you mean get healed? Well, we now know what it is. It's called catharsis. How many do not know what the word means, catharsis? Raise your hand. Catharsis. Okay. Catharsis is a verbal purging where you get everything out. It's called spiritual vomit, where you finally talk to someone. That's why in psychiatry, you know, you want to talk to someone. They can keep your secrets. It's confidential. So you're able to talk to a psychiatrist, and then you come out with stuff that comes out of there. Only you can speak to him or her and everything. And then after you do that, you feel good because you just vomited. But then they'll charge you like $200 for 15 minutes. Here, it's free. And it's voluntary. I'm not suggesting that we're going to bring everybody here and start vomiting and puking here. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying to you that you can do that on your own in your car. You can do that in your room. You can do that in your car. Or you can say, Lord Jesus, help me. I am guilty. Instead of faking the funk, don't be like Achan. He had to wait until the end, and finally, after he confessed it, and then the punishment came. And the Bible says that after the punishment came, we see there in verse 26 of chapter 7. Then they raised over Achan a great heap of stones still there to this day. Now notice the next phrase. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. So God was pacified. You see, in this narrative is what we call cause and effect. Cause and effect. What is a cause and effect? In a cause and effect, one event causes another to happen. The cause is why it happened, and the effect is what happened. So what is the cause? Achan stole something, and he transgressed the law of God. And what is the effect? God turned his back on the children of Israel. I'm not with you anymore. Your enemies are all around you. You are doomed, Israel. You're gone. So that's the cause and effect. The effect was a consequence, a result, an issue. Number one, Israel became overconfident. Some people ask me, do you pray for everything, Pastor? Do you pray for everything? I said, well, yeah. I mean, like, there's little things, you know, like, you want to, would you like a burger or a burrito? You pray things like that? No, not really. Those are insignificant things, whether you want pickles on in your hamburger, whether you want green or red salsa, or whether you want colored tortilla chips, green. Who wants that? A two-foot-long churro. Ridiculous. I don't pray for that. But I did pray this morning that I will be, that I'll make it to church from my house, because you never know. I do pray for my wife and my children. I did pray for our first service at 7:30. That will be wonderful, that the Lord will bless us, and God honor my simple prayer. I believe that we should pray for everything. I don't need you to stand down and order, oh Lord, should I add tacos or no tacos, Lord? Talk to me. That's ridiculous. But these people didn't pray. Israel was defeated. The children of Israel were chased down by the people of Ai, and 36 innocent men were killed. So fear gripped Israel. Their collective heart was terrorized and became like water, according to chapter 7, verse 5. So the theology is very clearly stated. Sin hinders God's presence with his people. When sin, unconfessed sin, enters in and sin manipulates you, unconfessed sin, it creates depression, discouragement, defeated, and dispirited. The word dispirited doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit is taken away from you. The word here, spirit, with a small s, is who we are, the animus, the animation that we have. You see, all of us have character and behavior, all of us. You have a behavior and you have a character. And that animates you, who you are, and what you know, the virtues that you know, the positions you hold, the postures you hold, the theology that you believe in. So you have this animus, you have this spirit. But when you are dispirited, you become sad. What contributes to the neglect and this disobedience and disloyalty to God? I call it the big D's in life. And it has nothing to do with the Dodgers' defeat. But the big D's in life. They're feeling disoriented. They are feeling desolated. But for you and I in our Christian life, there are times where you're going to experience discouragement. If you read about the weapons of Satan, he lies, he connives, he cheats, he's a scandalous guy, he takes advantage of your weaknesses. But his greatest weapon or tool that he has to mess with believers is one weapon that's very effective: discouragement. Discouragement. And there are reasons to be discouraged. No one's denying that what you're going through is not valid. It is valid. There are many factors in our society, in our culture, in our academics, in our marriage relationship, in the economics, in the politics of our country to cause you desolation. You may be in part of these, the big D's: desolation, dispirited, demoralization, deflation, disaster, disorder, depression, disease, death, drugs, drama, destitution, distress, despair, devastation, downhearted, discontentment, disapproval, devaluation, disappointment, discouragement, defeat, danger, depreciation, defenseless, disturbance, disillusionment, desperation, disenchantment, disgruntled, deranged, dread, displeasure, disarray, dread, dismay, dejection, dissatisfaction, despondency, divorce, dissolution, depression, dilemma, discomfort, deviance, disrespect, drugs, distraught, a divided heart. All of us. So what are the results here of the cause and effect? Well, according to chapter 7, verse 8, 2 times in 12, and 1 time in 13, Israel could not stand before their enemies. Israel was doomed to destruction because they had sinned and transgressed the Lord's covenant, chapter 7, verse 11. So after the execution of Achan, there in chapter 7, verse 26, in the middle, so the Lord turned from fierceness of his anger. So with evil purged from the nation, fellowship with God is restored, and victory again can come to Israel. So chapter 8 has to do now with encouragement. Chapter 8, restore courage. Now, by the very title, restore courage, that means that somewhere along the line, courage was absent. And it's true. They were very lamenting. They were sad. They were sorrowful. Even the leader of all the nation, Joshua, was dispirited and sorrowful and lamenting over the situation. So there was a courage change. Now, there are two movements in chapter 8. We're not going to do the second one, but I'll explain it to you how interesting and very inspiring and should be informative for every Christian. You see, you and I as Christians now, we're under grace, amen? When we sin, we have an option. If we confess our sins, if, you don't have to, but if we confess our sins, here's the character of God. He's faithful and he's just. He's fair and he's faithful to forgive us of all our sins and to hygienize or cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Based on what? Based on who Jesus is. Based on his grace. Based on his blood. Based as children of God. Receive mercy. In the Old Testament, it wasn't so. So there are two movements. The first movement we'll cover, verses 1 through 29, the battle against the city of Ai. And then from verse 30 to 35, something that Joshua does, like 20 miles north of the city of Ai, there's a present-day Samaria, which is now called the West Bank in Jerusalem, in Israel. And this area is called the Valley of Shechem, very sacred place because that's where Abraham built his first altar. This is where Isaac and Jacob, they built a well there. This is where Jesus met the Samaritan woman in that area, what we call today, modern-day Nablus, N-A-B-L-U-S, in the West Bank. According to Joshua, he built an altar, but he's doing it according to what Moses ordered, he commanded. So here's the situation. They get to the Valley of Shechem. There's a mountain here called the Mount Ebal, E-B-A-L. On this side, there's another mountain called Mount Gerizim. This is where the woman at the well said, "You Jews say we must worship in Jerusalem, but my father said we must worship in this mountain, Gerizim." So Joshua commanded in Deuteronomy 27 and 28. So that's your homework, okay? So if you're going to come next week, we're going to ask you in the front, have you read it? If you didn't read it, you go to your car and go read it. Then you're allowed to come in. Because you won't understand it, man. You have to read it, the horrible, damning curses of disobedience and the blessings of obedience. So God says, choose death or choose life. He gives them the option. Just, you want American cheese or Swiss cheese? What do you want? And so God gives them an option. So the children of Israel are divided into six tribes. So one tribe goes to Mount Gerizim and they recite the blessings of obedience. The other six tribes go to this mountain, Mount Ebal, and they hear the curses of disobedience. Horrible, man. Cannibalism is involved. Cannibalism. That the mothers will eat their own children. It's crazy, man. But it's true. It happened. And then after that, they switcheroo. The people that were hearing the curses, they go over here to hear the blessings. And the people that were hearing the blessings, they go and get the curses. Now they're aware what God expects from them. There are no excuses. And if you disobey, the curses are really damnable, deathly, terrifying. Thank God we're under grace. Thank God we're under grace. So we will not cover that. We will only cover the movement, verses 1 through 29. So in Joshua chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, tells you everything you should know. Everything. There's five things here, five things that you get here in Joshua chapter 8, verses 1. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "Do not be afraid. And do not be discouraged." This is NIV. Take the whole army with you and go up and attack Ai. For I have delivered into your hand the king of Ai, his people, his city, and his hand. You shall do to Ai and his king as you did to Jericho and his king, except that you may carry off their plunder and livestock for yourself. Set an ambush behind the city. So five things take place here. Number one, you see the divine encouragement. Fellowship is restored with God. In chapter 8, restoration with God. Then the Lord said to Joshua, do not be afraid. Echoing was the motto of the children of Israel. The echoing means in Deuteronomy 31, verse 8, this is the theme of the children of Israel in the promised land. And the Lord, he is the one who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear nor be dismayed. When Moses died and Joshua took over, four, five times God had to tell Joshua, do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. Do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. Why? Because he was afraid and he was discouraged. And God had to encourage him. So that's the first thing, the encouragement. Then you have a divine order. Take all the people of war with you and go up and attack Ai. Thirdly, there's a divine promise. For I deliver into your hand the king of Ai, his people, his city, and his land. And you shall do to Ai and his king as you did to Jericho and his king. What is God saying? I already defeated the enemy for you. It's in your hand. It's a done deal. He says, do the same thing you did to Jericho. What did they do to Jericho? They killed every breathing thing. And they killed a wholesale killing of Jericho. And they burned it down. Walls came down. Do the same thing. But there's that divine confidence. He said, except that you may carry off their plunder and livestock for yourselves. The word for plunder is a word that I don't like to use around here. It's booty. People make that booty. Yeah, booty, B-O-O-T-Y. It means all the valuable goods, especially those seized in war. In wartime, people take stuff, and it's the war, and you take whatever is valuable. It's the war. War is hell. And people take. So God says, you can take the gold, you can take the silver, you can take the animals, you can take whatever you want. And then lastly, there's a divine plan of attack. Set an ambush behind the city. The word ambush here is mentioned in verses 1 through 29 eight times. An ambush. It is called diversionary tactic. It's part of the military now. They use diversionary tactic. They're called military stratagems. In other words, you trick your enemy into fall into something. And so it's a classic warfare. So Joshua now has complete orders from God. It's not like the first time they went to Ai in chapter 7. They went diddy-bopping to Ai with no thinking, no plan. Now Joshua is personally involved. The book of Proverbs tells us that there's a way that seems right to a man, but as the end is the way of death. Proverbs 14:12. What does that mean? There's a way that seems right to a man. Well, when you operate without the auspice of God, when you live your life without the agency of God, when you live 24/7 without God, without any guidance, without any spiritual conviction, without any persuasiveness or holiness or righteousness, you do what you think is right. So sometimes when we make a decision based on what we think is right, we make it, but then it brings forth destruction. So it's not about, Lord, guide me, lead me. Joshua is paying very close attention to God. He understands obedience to God's command is indispensable for success. This time, human strategy is also a factor. Although Joshua is obeying orders, God's orders, Joshua conducts a prudent, well-planned operation in contrast to the overconfident display in the battle described in chapter 7. When I read this, I thought of the Sermon on the Mount, a little piece from it. And It is also in Matthew chapter 10, verse 16. This is what Jesus said to you and I, to his disciples. Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Therefore, be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. What? Serpents are never good. God doesn't want you to be conniving like a serpent. What God is telling you is to be prudent and wise as a serpent. We must combine simplicity with prudence. Some Christians are simply without having prudence. Some are prudent without simplicity. In other words, we are told in the book of Hebrews, chapter 2, verse 11, that when Jesus comes into our heart, God, the law of God comes in, he gives us prudence, discretion, the ability to navigate. It's a very important factor in your life. You need like another sixth sense to tell you, you can't go this way. You need someone to talk to into you. Oh, yeah, but this is right. This is what it should be. But there's something else telling you otherwise. You see, in 2008, for those of you that were here, we were going to build a sanctuary in the second building. It was going to be a replica almost of Italy. And we had the plans drawn. We had the architect from Newport Beach. And he had everything. Beautiful. It's going to be like an Italian villa. Beautiful. It's second building. $3 million. And we had permission from the city. Everything, they okayed everything. Everything was ready to go. Just sign right here. But the pastors and I, we felt something that was not clicking right. Was not, I don't know. I don't feel right. Ooh, it's a lot of money. And we're going to put the ministry, So then I made a decision. We're not going to build. And the bank says, what? Why not? You're ready to prove. And the architect says, I work all this. No, you got paid. What's the problem? And we backed out. And then the economic crash of 2008. Now, it wasn't because we have an inside thing to Wall Street, like, we know what's happening. We're a bunch of TJs. We don't know. But we made that decision, but not based upon what I think. It was based upon conviction, persuasion, that something is not right. Well, my wife, they said, okay, you have cancer in the brain. You have to have this cocktail. You ever hear a cocktail? Anybody in cancer, you know what a cocktail is, right? No? A cocktail is a mixture of all kinds of medication. They mix them all up. And some of them, anyway. So we told him, we want a second opinion. He got upset. You want a second opinion? What do you know about cancer? And, just the fact you're acting this way, I need a second opinion. So I remember him. Here, take a second opinion like that. Dog. And went to see another doctor. The doctor says, okay, we're going to open up your cranium. We're going to make a hole in your skull. We're going to put a little port in there. And then we're going to put a shunt in your brain. And we're going to go, that's worse. But guess what? We both looked at each other, both of us crying. And we said, let's go with it. Why? I don't know. But we did the right thing. What does that mean? There's a way that seems right to a man, but it brings forth destruction. When you are guided by God, he will close doors. He will turn off that relationship that you have. He will put down that business that you wanted so bad that he sees far ahead that business is going to ruin you. He sees all that, and he puts a stop to it, and you get angry. No. God's ways are always his ways. And so here we see how this is working out. So again, what causes us to have a mindset like Joshua here and the whole nation? As I shared with you, it was overconfidence. Sometimes there's spiritual complacency, there's bad decisions, attacks of doubt, fear, disappointment, frustration, anger, regret, judgment, criticism, gossip, and one bad experience after another will cause even the strongest person to lose heart. Stress, anxiety, angst, confusion, fright, apprehension, setbacks, moral failures, financial stress, marital friction, debt, married with children, unemployment, clarity of purpose in life, grief, illnesses, being single, unresolved issues. You have a multitude and a plethora of things that get you so upset. But God says, do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Why? I'm with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. So Joshua says, yes, sir. So God speaks to him. He tells him what needs to be done. Now, Joshua doesn't tell us at that moment, but God gave him a plan. God gave him the ability for him to use human strategy. Because when you take 5,000 men, that's 5,000 men is almost like a, what do they call it? We don't have in the Marine Corps, but they have in the Army, a brigade. That's like five battalions. And so it's almost like a division. That's a two-star general, a major general, two-star to do that. But it's Joshua. He takes it personal. In the first fighting in chapter 7, he didn't go. But this time, Joshua is the leader, and he's doing it. He's going to use a stratagem. But it's a stratagem in, again, an ambush. Verse 3. So Joshua rose and all the people of war to go up to Ai. And Joshua chose 30,000 mighty men of what? Valor. What does that mean, valor? If we say in Spanish, tiene valor, what does that mean? He has worth. So we said, oh, men of valor, or oh, bravery. No, not really. Oh, thank you. Millie. No, the word more, it means moral worth, merit, or courage, or stamina, or strength. So these men were selected men, and he sent them away by night. And that he commanded them, saying, behold, you shall lie in ambush against the city. So these people are going to be liars, L-I-E-R-S. There's an ambush against the city. And he said, behind the city, he told them, do not go very far from the city, but all of you be ready. Then I and all the people who are with me will approach the city, and it will come about when they come out against us as the first, that they will flee, they shall flee before them, for they will come out after us till we have drawn them from the city. For they will say, ah, they are fleeing before us as the first time. Therefore, we will flee before them. Then you shall rise from the ambush and seize the city, for the Lord your God will deliver it into your hand. And it will be when you have taken the city that you shall set the city on fire. Notice, according to the command of who? Commandment of the Lord, you shall do it. See, I have commanded you. So Joshua therefore sent them out, and they went out to lie in ambush, and they stayed between the city of Bethel and Ai on the west side of Ai. But Joshua lodged that night among the people. Then Joshua rose up early in the morning. He's an early riser. And he mustered the people and went up, he and the elders of Israel, before the people of Ai. And all the people of the war who were with him went up and drew near, and they came before the city and camped on the north side of Ai. In other words, Ai can check them out visibly already. Now, a valley lay between them and Ai, so he took about 5,000 men and set them in ambush between Bethel and Ai on the west side of the city. And when they had set the people, all the army that was on the north of the city and his rear guard on the west of the city, Joshua went that night into the midst of the valley. Now it happened when the king of Ai saw it that the men of the city hurried and rose early and went out against Israel to battle, he and all his people at an appointed place before the plain. But he did not know that there was an ambush against him behind the city. And Joshua and all Israel, they played the funk, see? They made it as if they were beaten before them. And they faking it. They fled by the way of the wilderness. So all the people who were in Ai were called together to pursue them. And they pursued Joshua. And they were drawn away from the city. There was not a man left in the city of Ai or Bethel who did not go after Israel. So they left the city, what? Open. And they pursued Israel. Then the Lord, 12 times he speaks to Joshua. Joshua, God told Joshua, stretch out the spear that is in your hand towards Ai, for I will give it to your hand. Now, like Moses, Moses did not have a spear. Moses had a what? A staff, the symbol of God. So Joshua stretched out the spear that was in his hand toward the city. So those in ambush arose quickly. That was the sign. Out of their place, they ran out as soon as he had stretched out his hand, and they entered the city and took it and hurried to set the city on fire. And when the men of Ai looked behind them, they saw, and behold, the smoke of the city ascended to heaven. And notice their reaction. So they had no power to flee this way or that. And the people who had fled to the wilderness turned back. So Joshua made a U-turn. And now they're going after them. Now when Joshua and all Israel saw that the ambush had taken the city and that the smoke of the city ascended, they turned back and struck down the men of Ai. Then the others came out of the city against them, so they were caught in the midst of Israel, some on this side and some on that side. And they struck them down so that they left none of them remain or escape. But the king of Ai they took alive and brought him to Joshua. And it came to pass when Israel had made an end of slaying all the inhabitants of Ai in the field, in the wilderness where they pursued them, and when they all had fallen by the edge of the sword until they were consumed, that all Israelites returned to Ai and struck it with the edge of the sword. So it was that all who fell that day, both men and women, were 12,000 of the people of Ai. For Joshua did not draw back his hand with which he stretched out the spear until he had utterly destroyed all the inhabitants of Ai. Verse 27, only the livestock and the booty or the spoil of that city Israel took as booty for themselves, according to the word of the Lord, which he had commanded Joshua. Verse 28, so Joshua burned Ai and made it a heap forever, a desolation to this day. And the king of Ai, he hung on a tree until evening. And as soon as the sun was down, Joshua commanded that they should take his corpse down from the tree. That's according to the law. Deuteronomy chapter 21, 22. According to the law, you cannot leave a corpse hanging overnight. So they commanded they should take his corpse down from the tree, cast it at the entrance of the gate of the city, and raise over it a great heap of stones that remain to this day. A different concept. Now they have fellowship with God. Now God is back in the forefront of their lives. Again, and when we get next week, please read Deuteronomy 27, 28. Because they're going to have a renewal of the covenant. And every person is going to be accountable for their actions. And you're going to see that living in grace is much more better than living in the Old Testament. The grace of God. Amen. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for your time. If you would like to receive Jesus, I don't think everybody here is a Christian. You came looking, and you're going to leave without Jesus. You know why people wait in their deathbed to make a deathbed confession to someone you don't even know? Today, you can make that confession. Lord, I confess that you are Lord. I confess that you're the Messiah. And I confess that I have need of you. Volitionally, I ask you to come into my heart. No one can force you, but that's something you can do to receive the Lord today. If that is you, whether you're here, next door, third building, or watching online, if you would like to receive the Lord this morning, would you just let me know by raising your hand and say, Ponch, I want to receive Jesus today. If that is you, could you raise your hand, whomever you may be, quickly, whoever you may be, quickly. Are we good? Are we all good? Are we good? Next door, are we all good? We're good. God bless you. God bless you. Well, God bless you. God bless you. Good move. Good choice. Anybody else? God bless you. Way in back. God bless you. Anybody else? Good choice. Don't leave without Jesus. Watch out. Is this, man? That's it. You know why you can't do that? Because this right here is holding it right here. Let it go. For once in your life, just do this. I want Jesus. As easy as that. Anybody else? Anybody else? Are we good? Are we good? We're good. For those of you that raise your hand, would you repeat the simple prayer after me? You're welcome to a brand new Bible free on us, right here to my left, to your right. For the meantime, would you repeat the simple prayer after me in your heart or out loud? Oh, Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I repent of all my sin. Jesus, I make a confession that I need you. I make a confession that I'm a sinner. Forgive me. Come into my heart. Make me a new person with a new mind, a new heart. Put my name in the book of life forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand.
Every tribe, every tongue, every heart will sing. Every knee we will bow to the risen King. Lift him up, never gonna stop singing. Every tribe.
Sunday.